Hello and welcome to Unpacking My Privilege, a resource for intersectional feminists who want to change the world. My name is Chanel Peterson. My pronouns are she and her, and I am so infinitely grateful to have you here listening today. Today, we are talking with Lana Patel. This is part three of a conversation with her. Our first episode was about gender-affirming healthcare, and we talked a little bit about her job with Plume and what gender-affirming healthcare is. Then we talked about dating as a trans woman. She was extremely vulnerable with us, and she shared about her first kiss, her losing her virginity, and the heartbreaking and scary situations that she has had to endure as a Black trans woman trying to navigate love. And today we are talking about how trans kids know they're trans early on. In this particular episode, Lana talks about her childhood and how her childhood was really difficult only because her parents were not supportive of her journey. And so I think that this is a particularly fitting conversation, especially about what's happening in the news. We have places like Florida trying to pass the Don't Say Gay bill, who actually were successful in passing the Don't Say Gay bill. If you're not aware, the Don't Say Gay bill actually prevents teachers from teaching about LGBTQ people. And that is something we absolutely do not want. We do not want the erasure of LGBTQ people. And it's so interesting because a lot of Lana's story is in Florida. And so I think you'll be able to connect a lot about what's happening now with what happened, you know, back when she was a kid about like 10, 20 years ago. So without further ado, please welcome Lana Patel to the podcast. So I think that we need to address the fact that kids know early on if they agree with the gender that they were assigned. Like even going so far as to talk about like sexuality, I knew that I liked boys when I was, I don't know, 5 years old in kindergarten. Like kids know. And so I would love for you to talk a little bit about like children and how we need to affirm them.
Yeah. I was 3 years old when I knew I was a girl. And, you know, I remember watching Kindergarten Cop. And he said, the little boy goes, boys have a penis and girls have a vagina. And I'm like, wait, I don't have a vagina. What's going on? You know, but I remember being a little kid and I'm like, why am I not wearing dresses? Like, why isn't like my hair being like braided and like I'm wearing cute bows and berets and where are my Mary Jane shoes? Where is my Barbie? Where's my Barbie Jeep? Where's my Barbie house? Why should I wear that pink? Like all the things I saw all the girls have, I'm like, why don't I have these things? Like, what is going on? Identified with girls so much to where like every time my parents took me over to someone's house and there was a girl there, I was always playing with her and I was always playing with Barbie and I would get in trouble all the time for it. For me, I grew up with immigrant parents who had immigrant parents. I mean, you know, my grandparents came to this country and they brought my parents. And my parents were born and raised in a very misogynistic, I wouldn't say transphobic because they didn't even know what trans was, but like homophobic, cishet society where it was very about the patriarchy. Men are everything in the Caribbean. To be a cis, like, there's only cishet men, right? And women have their place, and they have this idea of everyone is cisgender and everyone is heterosexual. And to not be cishet means that you are an abomination, that you are, you're against, like, mankind, humankind, there's like a defect in like this system, like, but they see it as if you're like the devil, as if you're the snake in the Garden of Eden, that you're temptation, like people choose to be gay, people choose to be deviants, to society, that you want to be different. They don't have the education and the knowledge around it. But my family also comes from a culture where honor killings are practiced. And so it's common to witness someone in the street being murdered for being gay, and people just stand there and watch because they deserve it, because they're an abomination, because they're against mankind. Like, you know, they're messing up the code of reproducing and moving generation. I don't know, but coming out meant that I could potentially be disowned. I wasn't sure what the future would look like, but I knew that at that time I was going to have to join a witness protection program, move to the Midwest, change my life, you know, like fake my death or something, because there was no way at that time I like believed that my family would ever accept me. And, you know, as a little kid, it was, I loved dolls. I wanted so much to just be a girl, just to express myself. My stepdad would always joke with me. He's like, oh, do you want to be a girl? And I would always want to say yes, but always I would say no, because I didn't know what the reaction would be. I'm like, this is a tricky thing. Why do you keep asking me this, right? But it was evident that I was feminine. And prior to puberty hitting, I passed as a girl. You know, I had a high voice. I was short. I was like always one of the smallest kids in class, very petite. If you didn't know I was assigned male at birth, you would assume I was female. And that for me was really affirming. I loved people seeing me as a girl, but I also knew my genitalia was not the same as other girls. I knew that I was assigned male at birth and that I wasn't allowed to go to school as a girl, or like just live my life as a girl, to play, to have girl toys. You know, I can go play with the girls and then I have to leave the dolls there and go home. And I was five or six, going to summer camp. There was a garage sale kind of thing, and someone had a table full of stuff that they were selling, and I happened to have $5 on me. And there was a doll, it was like a cloth doll. I bought the doll, and it was a cloth doll with like yarn for hair and this cute blue dress. And I was so happy because it was the first time I like owned a doll. I was like, oh my gosh, this is mine. I didn't have pockets, so I didn't have a way to hide the doll. And so I went home, I had it with me. And I remember my parents saw the doll and they took it away, and my stepdad threw it in the trash. And I went back in the trash, I took my doll back out, and he found the doll again. He threw it back in the trash and he poured food on top of it so I wouldn't get it. And I was just like so crushed, because I was like, that's my doll. Like that's what I like, you know, like, why can't I have this? Like, this is who I am. You know, I always knew who I was. It was just my family didn't know. Like, it took time for them to get on board and to recognize my identity. And I felt like I was playing charades almost, like I was living a lie for them. I was portraying a person that they assumed I was supposed to be based off of what the doctor told them when I came out of my mother, you know. And no one truly heard me. No one really understood me and listened. And that was really frustrating. I was 11. When I had language and understood really who I was. And I would say like 9 is when I was like 8 or 9. I was watching a talk show with my stepdad. She probably shouldn't have been watching it. It was a mature audience type of stuff. But you know, growing up, representation for the LGBTQ community, especially the trans community, like, we had Maury, we had Jerry Springer, we had like Ricky Lake and Jenny Jones and those type of things. So at best, you could be Jenny Jones, Ricky Lake, where they would actually talk about talk to folks. And there was this show, I think it was Ricky Lake, and she had a Black trans woman in Philadelphia named Erica. And we got to do like a day in the life. And I got to see her take her hormones, and she had like made this tucking device to hide her genitalia, and she was getting dressed. She went and got whacked. She was like walking down the street. Guys are catcalling her. And I was like, that's me. I'm Erica. You know, I just saw it and I knew it. And I remember I overheard a conversation with my stepdad and his friend, and they were talking about this incident in the club. And my stepdad's friend met a woman, and he said, oh, I saw this woman in the club, but she told me she was a man. And he was like, I don't understand. How was she a man? She looked just like a woman. She had breasts and everything. And my stepdad said, yeah, they inject themselves with hormones. And I was like, oh, that's how I can do it. So they knew, but I was just like an observant child, just always taking in information. But when I was 11, I saw this show called Queer as Folk. And Queer as Folk was the thing that opened my eyes to the community and helped me understand my sexuality. And I knew that I liked boys, but this was like that eye opener for me. Also, not a show I should have been watching at 11 years old, TVMA, but there was a character named Justin. And the show followed a bunch of queer folks, mainly cis. It was like white cis men, white cis gay men. There was one guy that he had a mom that was super affirming. Justin had a best friend. She was affirming. And then there's a lesbian couple. There was no trans representation. There was no POC representation. Like maybe the best friend, like she could have been mixed. She was just ambiguous kind of looking, but everyone was just white folk. And I couldn't connect with them based off of identity as far as, you know, gender, as far as ethnicity. But I saw parallels within myself and the character Justin. It was that summer when I realized that I like boys. And I had a moment of like thinking, well, maybe I'm bisexual. To me, it seemed easier to be bisexual because I don't know, it was like palatable. It was easier to deal with. I could still like girls and then like boys. But then I sat with myself and I'm like, no, I just like guys. Like, I don't like girls. I want to be a girl. I am a girl, but I don't want to like date them. And it was like then when I truly understood who I was, but it was also daunting because I'm like, what do I do with this information? How do I move forward? I have a family that is not going to accept this. Like, it's not going to be okay to be gay. And I also am dealing with the whole trans piece. Like, how do I navigate a transition? How do I become the woman that I feel like on the inside? How do I make that into a reality? And so I kind of fell into like a depression. And I think my family was like noticing that. And I was 12 when I came out. And I just got back from Florida visiting my grandparents for the summer. And my eighth grade teacher had us write an essay on what we did that summer. And I don't know why, what compelled me to come out to this woman in an essay, but I did. And I told her, I'm gay, I'm trans. Like, cause I was a kid that was picked on all the time. I don't really recall times where I wasn't picked on because I was effeminate, because I was female passing, passing as a kid. All the other boys in my classes would always bully me, pick on me, beat me up and stuff. And they would call me names. And I was like, you know, they call me all these things, but it's true. I am all the things that they say that I am. I'm gay. I'm a girl. And then there was a fire drill, because I was in New York, born and raised in New York, and it was the height of 9/11. The Twin Towers had just recently fallen, and we had a bomb threat at school. Someone had called and said there was a bomb or something. So we had to do a fire drill on the building, and we were walking around the building, and my teacher comes up to me, and she said, I read what you wrote in that essay. What you said was very serious. Did you mean that? And I told her, yes, I did. And she said, okay, well, I rent my basement to a nurse who works with LGBTQ youth. I'm going to talk to her and get some resources for you. And
thank God,
because of her.
Thank God she reacted like that, because she could have very well been like not somebody who was going to affirm you.
Yeah. I got lucky. Like, I had no idea this woman was going to be an advocate for me, that she was going to be affirming and accepting. I just went for it and wrote my heart out in that essay. And she got me connected to the school counselor. And every week we would sit and talk. So it was my, you know, eighth grade English teacher, my counselor, and I. And she really, like, helped me come to terms with myself. She really pushed me to be a better student, a better writer. And, you know, I found a love for literature and like, writing because of her. And the kids would pick on me and say, like, oh, I'm her favorite. Like, they would say I'm her son because the way she, like, looked out for me. But, and she, it was interesting because, like, everyone avoided her because she was the mean teacher. Like, no one really liked her. She was always mean, and I was the only one she was not mean to. And so kids are like, what is this treatment? Like, how did you crack, like, the mean teacher and get through to her? But it was a really special connection that we had, and I'm so grateful. And, like, how she played a role in my life, and I am me because of her. And she got me connected with my mother so that I can come out. So my counselor, my English teacher, my mother, and I sat in the room, and I came out to her and I told her I was gay and I was trans. I was so nervous. And my mom, she, I don't know, it was really weird. I was nervous because I felt like, oh, my mom, you know, she went to beauty school. She was a beautician. I would hear her say, like, she, like, had friends that were, like, gay or bisexual. Like, she knew people in the community. So I was like, oh, my mom, like, she, like, is going to be super supportive. And when I came out, my mom was just, like, kind of stoic. And I didn't really know how to take it. So then she told my stepdad started telling the family. And I was just nervous. And they connected us with a counselor. So we went to a counselor once. My parents practiced Christianity. At the time, they were not religious or even spiritual. But we went to the counselor, and my stepdad says, oh, we don't need to go to the counselor. We can use the Bible. And so that was his answer. Just religion will fix this. My teacher gave me some resources for some affirming spaces. And I was excited, but I was nervous. I was, I don't know, like, what do I do with this? You know, like, potentially meeting other queer kids. And so I kind of just left it there. But I was navigating my gender identity and also my sexual orientation. I had a journal, and I wrote everything in my journal, and I had crushes on three boys that I happened to be friends with, all three of them. And I had my best friend come out to two of them, and I had another friend come out to the other one and tell them that I liked them. I don't know what I was thinking, 12 years old in middle school, eighth grade, thinking I'm gonna come out to these boys, but I did. And the reception was not great. So they all stopped befriending me, and they, you know, kind of isolated me. One of them, like, shoved me, like, really hard, I think, like, into a closet or something, like, because I got near him. And there was just, like, homophobia from all of them, and I lost my friends in the process. But I also was living my truth. And I remember the kids would, like, just kind of pick on me, and they stole my journal and ripped out the pages and spread it amongst everyone. And before I knew it, like, the whole school knew I was gay and trans, and it was very interesting to have to navigate that. And I was also figuring out, like, my gender identity. So I would wear like really tight fitting clothes. I had a gothic face, wore black, did black nails, black liner and all that stuff. Saw the craft, fell in love with it. I was like, I want to be a part of the craft. What I would do, I would go to Rite Aid. I'd buy like my makeup, nail polish and all that stuff. I would hide it in my bag. And then I would take the bus to school, like the public transportation. So I'd get on the bus and I start doing my liner, I'd do my nails. Like I would get ready and I'd go to school. And then when I went back home, I had to take everything off. And so when I got home, my parents would know that I was wearing makeup or my paint on my nails. And my mom used to have a pantry with all of her toiletries, but the pantry that she would keep toiletries in was stuff that she wasn't using, because if she was using it, it would sit on her vanity. So I would just help myself to her things. I'm like, oh, you're not using this perfume, I'll take this. Oh, you're not using this body spray. So I started building a little collection. What my mom would do is like, I would get the stuff and like try to hide it in my bag or under my pillow. She would find it and take it back. So it was like this tug of war. And I just wanted so bad to understand what it was like to be a woman, to be a girl, to be a pubescent girl, to like understand what that journey was like, because I was hitting puberty at that time and I shot from 5 foot to 5'7". My voice got deeper, my hands got bigger, my feet, you know, like I had acne and oily skin and I was being served like on the phone. I was always man, and for the first time people are like gendering me male, and that was really traumatizing. I wanted the puberty that I read about. Like I was like, where's my breast growth? Why are my hips spreading? Where's my period? Like I wanted that puberty. And so I would like take my mom's like period products, panty liners and pads, and I'm like, oh, I'm going to put this on my underwear. Like, I want to understand. I want to feel with that. I want to know what that feels like. So, you know, I would do that. My mom would find stuff. She'd take it back. And tensions were just high. And it got to the point where my mom and I were just at war. It was really tough. And we didn't talk, basically. Like, yeah, we lived in the same house and we wouldn't talk. And my grandmother, who lived in Florida, was like the conduit, basically. So if there was a message, my mother would call my grandmother, tell her, and then my grandmother would call me and tell me. And if I had something for my mother, I would tell my grandmother, my grandmother would tell my mother. And we lived in the same house, but we didn't talk. And if I wanted to communicate with my mother, I had to email her. I would send her emails, or my grandmother would give me the message. So it was really tough. Tensions were just really high at home. You know, the show that I was speaking of, like back then in the day, when I was like 8 or 9, my stepdad was watching, I think, Jenny Jones or Ricky Lake, and there was a gay couple on there. And he said, they deserve to burn in hell. This is what I'm trying to protect you and your brother from. And that scared me. I was like, I don't know if I can come out. Like, this man is not going to accept me. And, you know, during that time, we have Maury. There were women that would get on stage and the crowd would say, Maury, that's a man. We had Jerry Springer. Trans women were on stage getting their wigs pulled off, you know, people fighting and saying, Jerry. And it was just a spectacle. We had cops. Like, you see transgender, at the time it was transsexual, that was the term, prostitutes, right? Like, that's how the world viewed us. We were parading around as women, being called a man by the audience. We were getting our wigs pulled off and getting beaten up because we were hiding our trans identity from our lovers and Jerry Springer. And we were getting arrested for prostitution on cops. And so I didn't have positive representation as a trans person growing up. And I didn't know what was possible as a trans person growing up either. I just knew that I feared what growing into an adult male would look like. I didn't want that. I couldn't see myself married with a wife and children. And so I ended up moving out of my mother's house, and I moved to Florida with my grandparents, and they raised me from 13 till 26. And
so your grandparents seem to be really like good, because you know, when you weren't talking to your mom, you would go through your grandma. So that's mm-hmm. They were good for you, right?
They were good, but there was also trauma there too. When I would get allowance, I'd get money, I would save it. And then I started working on my Barbie collection. So I was around like 11 and I had this huge doll collection. Every chance I got, I went to the mall, I bought a new doll. I went to Walmart, I bought a new doll. I was obsessed with Mary-Kate and Ashley. I had a bunch of Mary-Kate and Ashley dolls. I would get the Barbie dolls, the Bratz dolls, all of it. And one day I was playing and my little brother, so we had a, we were in Queens. There was like a three-story, or like we had, there was a basement, there was a main floor, there was a second floor, there was the third floor, which is the attic. And I, my bedroom was on the attic floor. We had two bedrooms. And my brother like knocked and asked if he can come in and like hang out with me and play with me. My brother and I were like cat and dog. We never got along. We were just different. He's a Scorpio, I'm a Libra. We just were always at each other's throats. And he was like the golden child. And I was the black sheep of the family. And I was always in his shadow and always being compared to him. So I let my brother come in. He's like playing with his cars or whatever. I'm playing with my Barbies and we're just, you know, doing our thing. And so my stepdad comes up and I didn't even hear him come. He opens the door and I throw my Barbies across the room and he like comes in and he's like, oh, like, you know, what are you two doing? Like, you never hang out with your brother. You never let him in your room. And so like, he's like, you know, kind of laughing and talking to me for a second. And he looks over and sees the dolls. And he's like, what is that? And he takes the dolls away. And he's like, I don't understand why you're like this. Like, what's wrong with you? And he's just like, is this something? He's like, you know, no one in your mother's family is like this. Like, where did you get this from? You know, and he had an idea of, like, this was a gene that was passed on. Maybe someone gave me the gay gene because he couldn't understand why I was like this. And so, you know, it was that mentality. And then moving with my grandparents for older generation, immigrants that have no idea about trans and gender variants and LGBTQ community. So while my grandmother was super supportive, supportive of me in general, she couldn't wrap her head around my identity, my sexual orientation. And she was a newfound Christian as well. So she looked at it from a biblical Christian lens, and in her mind, from her teachings, that it was wrong to be me. So it was an uphill battle with them because my grandfather, it was obscure to him. He didn't really know how to connect with me because he was like, I only know boys who like girls, men who like women. Like, what is this? And my grandmother just, I don't know, she thought maybe religion would fix me. So while they were supportive, it was tough for a long time.
I know that, like, at this time, you know, you're still trying to figure out, like, your own identity. And eventually, like, you have solidified, like, yes, I am a trans woman. Do you still identify as gay, or are you straight, or, like?
Yeah, so I identify as straight woman.
Because I know you like
but boys. At that time, yeah, I like guys. At that time, I hadn't transitioned. So I still presented as male to the world. So it was, I knew I was a girl, but then, like, how I presented was gay, male, I guess. Or, like, because I was presenting as male, like, my gender orientation my sexual orientation would be gay, in a way. Although I never experienced life as a gay male. And, like, my first encounters with men romantically were after transition. But, I ended up getting enrolled into a Christian high school. Basically was traumatized and bullied and picked on. And at the time, the term queer was derogatory, especially in the South. They would call me queer and they would write queer on my locker, break in my locker, write queer on my books. They would take post-it notes and put queer on a post-it note and slap it on my back, yell out queer in class. I was just constantly being ridiculed and taunted.
And this was in Florida, right? At the time with your grandparents, mm-hmm. right? The Don't Say Gay bill. Like, come on.
Yeah.
Say gay, but not say queer, but don't say it in a derogatory way.
Yeah.
Sorry, continue.
Yeah. So, no, you're good. I, once the kids basically got wind that I was different, everything changed. And, you know, I would go to the locker room for PE, and the boys would like shield themselves, like they would hide away, because they didn't want to change the locker room with me. And so this church basically took over half the town that we lived in. They had kindergarten or preschool up till college. So it was like K through 12 school. They had a university or a college or university. They had a bookstore, they had a radio station, they had a major church, a Spanish church, K through 12 church. They had a senior living center. Like, this place was massive. They literally took over half the town. They were very powerful people. And it was almost cult-like. And my grandparents, you know, they went, they found some community within this church, and they were the only Black and brown. My grandfather's Indian. My grandmother, she's half Black, half white from Jamaica. And they were the only Black and brown couple in the whole county. And this is the largest county in Florida. And they were an anomaly. It was just like really daunting and awkward to just be in that space. I kind of dreaded being at school. And there was one guy in particular that would always pick on me and say, at least I'm going to be here next week. At least I'm going to be here next week. And so one day I get called into the principal's office, and they tell me I have to start doing counseling, Bible counseling. So every week I have to meet with the Bible teacher and I have to counsel. So I'm doing that extra on top of everything else I have going on. And then one day some girl in the class yells out, "I'm wearing makeup." So they call me to the principal's office. They get the brown, you know, the paper towels, like those brown paper towels that you get to like dry your hands. They made me wipe my face with that. And I'm like, this paper towel is the same color as my skin. One, two, I'm a pubescent, like male. I have oily skin. So the oil is going to come off on this paper. And so they're sitting there like examining the paper to see if I was wearing makeup. And it was just like constantly being picked on. I had grown my hair out at the time, or I was able to get a haircut. So I was growing it out in a way. And I think my hair like came below my eyebrows, and on the side, it was like covering my ear. And as a boy, you had to cut it, like it couldn't go past your ear, and like, I don't know, there was like certain rules for how you had to groom your hair as a boy. And I was just like being picked on, you know. They're like, "Oh, your hair is too long," and it just was like so frustrating, you know. So one day I get called into the principal's office again, and my grandmother is sitting there with bloodshot eyes, and she's crying, and I'm like, "What's going on?" My grandparents are sitting there with the principal, and the principal tells me they have to withdraw me from the school. They said that they would rather I leave than parents come and take their kids out of school, because they don't want their kids going to school with the queer. And they gave me a box, and they walked me to my locker. I packed everything I had in my locker, and I got in the backseat of the car, and I drove off. And my grandmother was heartbroken, because her plan for me was to be this good kid going to this Christian school. And then it moved into a space of kind of hostility. Like, my grandparents resented me for getting withdrawn from school, and it just left a really awkward space to live in. My grandmother was passive aggressive, and my grandfather, when we got home, he said, "Please don't mess this up for us. This is our church family." And I was just like, "Wait, but I'm your actual family. I'm like your flesh and blood. Like, why is your first response those people in the church and not me?" And so it just felt like I was battling this on my own. And so they would go to church 3 times a week. They go to church Sunday morning, Sunday evening, and I think on Wednesday nights. And on Sundays, Sunday morning was like the K-12 church. So I would go to K-12 church and I would sit there in silence for hours. I'd get there like 8, 9 o'clock, leave at like 1, 2, not talk to anyone because no one wanted to befriend me, talk to me. No one would sit next to me. They treated me like I had leprosy, like I had something contagious that they were going to get. No one would even share the Bible with me. When they were passing the offering plate, they would like pinch their like thumb and index finger and hand it over to me. I just felt horrible in that space. And it was like, these kids are so hypocritical. Like, how is it that we're supposed to be learning how to be Christian and Christ-like, but they're not anything like how Jesus was supposed to be. Like, he was someone who hung out with prostitutes and tax people and like didn't judge anyone, and here I am being judged for who I am. And so I was just sick of it, and I was like, I don't want to do this anymore. So I just started coming up with excuses and saying I was sick every Sunday until, you know, they stopped asking questions and I stopped going to church. But when I got withdrawn from school,
I was just going to say, and you're just a little bit older than me. So literally we're talking, this is happening probably in like 2003. Yeah. That's third grade.
No, it was 2002 into 2003. Yeah.
I just think it's always, it's so important to like remind people that like, these are not archaic. Like they're not things that people used to think. They're like, these people that are doing this to you are probably still alive and well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So once I got withdrawn from the school, they enrolled me in their homeschooling program, and they also enrolled me in conversion therapy. And so I navigated conversion therapy that my mother was paying for. I found out after I decided I had enough of Florida. I wanted to move back home to New York. I was tired of being in a rural area. I was ready to see my friends, to be able to walk around and get places on foot, to take a bus and a train. And I was a city kid. And my mother told me I couldn't come back home. And I was stuck there. And so, you know, I had to cram my whole freshman year in one semester in homeschooling because I lost all my credits when I got withdrawn from school. And I had to navigate this religious psychologist that was providing conversion therapy and
We've done an episode on conversion therapy, like literally, and because specifically I was talking with Chenille Lal, and they actually were very successful in passing the ban on conversion therapy in New Zealand. And the way that they describe conversion therapy is legalized torture, like legalized torture. So very interested to hear, like, how did that go for you? How long were you there?
Yeah, I was there for, I would say, maybe 3 months. And I mean, obviously it didn't work. I'm a full-blown woman now and dating men. So much for the conversion therapy. It was a waste of time and a waste of money. My mom could have saved that money, done something else, given it to me. But I look back on it, you know, it was traumatizing, but like, I don't know. It's like, I had all these hardships that in the end made me stronger, but I also would never want another trans kid to have to deal with that, like to be bullied up until you're withdrawn from school, to then have to be in conversion therapy, and like just dealing with the nonsense that I had to deal with. And it's a lot, you know, like we look at the suicidality of the LGBT community, especially the trans community, 41% you know, it's 82% of folks that have had suicidal ideation, and 41% attempt suicide. Mm-hmm. I never want to see someone be put in that situation.
And like, I can't imagine anybody listening to like what you've gone through. And you know, what a hot topic right now is trans men in women's sports. Like, mm-hmm. they have to go through all of this shame and just bullshit. And all America sees is, somebody pretending to be, trans women in women's sports assigned man at birth. Like, why would they go through all of that hubbub and trauma just to like win a medal? Like, that's, uh-huh. yeah. And I did just want to mention that, you know, throughout your story, you talk about how you love dolls and how you loved makeup and, you know, you wanted to wear dresses and things like that. And I kind of want to just reiterate to the listeners that those things aren't what make you a woman. You are a woman because you are a woman. Like, why am I a woman? I know I am. I can't explain it. And it's so silly to me that makeup and dresses and the color pink are like inherently for girls. Uh-huh. And it also makes me think about how, like, the men, like boys' things are universal. So like girls, it's cool if they like princesses and dinosaurs and race cars, but boys uh-huh. that like princesses are weird. Uh-huh. You know? So it's just so.
Yeah.
And that's why I always say that trans, non-binary, and gender non-conforming folks should be the lead, the head of feminism, because, like, you know, their existence challenges, like, this two-system binary and what it actually means to be a woman and what it actually means to be a man.
Yeah, you know, I think that we've allowed cishet folks to define that for so long. And they have, for the most part, no idea what it's like to live outside of that binary, what it's like to be on a gender variance or a gender spectrum. And it's something that's like so nuanced. And, you know, what I see happening with trans youth is disheartening. States where it's illegal to provide gender-affirming care to trans youth, states where, you know, like Texas, where you can report someone's parents for child abuse because they're supporting their trans child. It's insane. And they just want to express themselves and identify as the people that they are. And I wish I had that as a kid. I wish my parents were affirming and accepting. I wish I could have transitioned at an earlier age. It would have saved me so much trauma and just would have led to higher quality of my life, where I could just go to school and like be with other girls, you know, experience homecoming and prom as a girl, you know, like navigate my education in college and university without wondering, like navigating a transition, having to figure out surgeries and procedures and when I can even do things, because I have classes from August until December. Like, when do you have time to even recover from surgery? It's cruel to like remove these options, to remove access to trans kids, trans youth, and continue gatekeeping. It's bewildering that people don't see it that way, that they just for some reason are like, no, this is not right, trans kids should not be able to be themselves or access care or whatever. And it's this whole idea of like, oh, if we start teaching gender studies, we talk about sexual orientation, that we're gonna start making gay kids, LGBTQ kids, queer and trans. And it's like, I didn't get that education and I'm still trans. I still like guys. Like, having access to that did not make me who I am. So many people who are cisgender and heterosexual got, like, are just themselves, and they didn't learn through sex education. They just always identify that way. And it's absurd to believe that, you know, because you learn about identities other than yourself, that you're going to then want to be a different gender identity or sexual orientation than how you identify prior to getting that knowledge.
I hope you loved that episode with Lana. I know that I could literally talk to her for hours, and we probably will in the future. I would love to have her on again. She is brilliant and kind, and I just admire her so much, and I really thank her for being on this podcast. So don't forget to shoot on over to @ChanelPetersonOfficial, my Instagram account, to tell me, you know, any of the thoughts that you had about this episode, maybe some suggestions for what you'd like to see in the future. Tell me about what you've learned, anything and everything. Let me know, and I love you all so much.